Hey everyone, I'd like to tell you the story of George Whitefield and talk about his life and theology a little bit. So George Whitefield was born in England in 1714. He enrolled in Oxford, and there he met Charles and John Wesley, and they formed what was called the Holy Club. But they were so intense that at one point Whitefield fasted to the extent that a doctor needed to be called. In 1735, Charles Wesley gave Whitefield a copy of Henry Scogal's book, The Life of God in the Soul of Man, and he later wrote in his journal, "I was delivered from the burden that had so heavily oppressed me." At age 21, he was ordained in the Church of England, but his preaching included offensive language, people thought, because he included Romans 3:23, that all had sinned and fall short of the glory of God, even telling church people they needed to repent. As a result, he never took a pulpit in England and had to preach in the open air, becoming a missionary to numerous countries. His first congregation, so to speak, were thousands of coal miners meeting in the fields to hear Whitefield preach. Whitefield wanted to bring revival to the American colonies, and they were heavily divided because of denominationalism. He became friends with Jonathan Edwards, and together they preached all over the colonies to hundreds of thousands of people over 5 months. Revival broke out across the land in what is known as the First Great Awakening. Whitefield blamed the clergy for the apathy in the churches. He said, "I'm persuaded that the generality of preachers' talk of an unknown and unfelt Christ, the reasons why congregations have been so dead is because they have dead men preaching to them. And how can dead men beget living children?" So for Whitefield, theology was not a series of abstract precepts or topics for endless dissection. Whitefield saw the scripture more as a story than a theological handbook. Theology was the retelling of the drama of God's action in the world, the narrative that invites the listener to become one of the participants in the extending the glory of God and God's story, God's action. God's story stretches from eternity past to eternity future. Whitefield held to a covenant theology of the Puritans, although he had started as a Methodist and their Arminian views. He became a convinced Calvinist during his second voyage to the Americas. He taught that the covenant of redemption began with a pact between the two persons of the triune God. The Father and Son formed an agreement in which the Father committed himself to giving his Son a people, and the Son agreed to die for those people. Whitefield wrote to Wesley once, "Get acquainted more and more with the electing love. Study the covenant of redemption and see how God loved you with an everlasting love. This will cause you to glory only in the Lord and to pass from death, from the shadow of death, to a full assurance of faith, knowing Christ has engaged to lodge you safely in eternal glory." He believed theological constructs should not be allowed to become the dominant method of expression. For Whitefield, theology that takes Scripture as its authority should be expressed primarily in scriptural, not human language. Whitefield articulated a federalist theology and told the story of Adam, who was given a covenant of works, and yet the covenant of grace is first revealed in Genesis 3, where the story of Christ begins. Whitefield's contribution theologically may be seen in his interpretation of the resurrection. Rather than focusing on the resurrection as being the basis for believers' hope in a bodily resurrection, Whitefield is more interested in the connection to regeneration. In his sermon entitled "The Power of Christ's Resurrection," it typifies his theology. He preached, And as he rose again from the dead, so must we also rise to a divine life. His emphasis on the new birth explains where Christ currently is, and this reveals the heart of Whitefield's theology, namely union with Christ. Again, Whitefield proved by his life and actions of being one of the foremost evangelists of the 18th century the necessity to preach the gospel with clarity and passion and simplicity to the whole world by telling the unfolding story of the covenant of grace in Jesus Christ. It was not necessarily a new theology, however, his commitment to the orthodoxy of Calvinism as birthed in the relationship between God the Father and God the Son was approached as a loving response to an all-loving God. His love for Jesus Christ was so contagious and infectious, his voice so thunderous, his compassion for the lost so complete. He inspires many to live a life fully committed to God, allowing the Spirit to fill one's life with the excellencies of Jesus. He tells us in his writings to place our affections like a lover on Christ, and so begin to emulate Christ's life, Christ's humility, Christ's ways, Christ's affections, and Christ's devotion to God. Thank you.